name is Mike Gingell. I'm the chairman of the Board of Commissioners, and we want to welcome you. This is an effort between the Board of Commissioners, the Water Resource Commissioner Office, Commissioner Jim Nash, who's here from our Water Resource Commissioner, and the County Executive's Office. We know that that a lot of things have moved quickly over the last week or so on water. You're hearing a lot of things in the news about it, and we want to take an opportunity today to provide a venue so that we can talk to you about the constructs of the deal, the tenets of the deal, and why Oakland County is now getting behind and supporting the proposal. So this morning at our board meeting, we initiated the Water Resources Authority and through a resolution, which will be going through our committee process. And we have been working diligently over the last several months with the board through a water study group, which today I'm pleased to recognize Bob Gosling, who's the chairperson of our water study group. And you heard our team come forward and ask a lot of questions, ask a lot of information from Detroit. The good news is we've gotten the answers we feel we need to be able to make decisions. So today we're going to share a lot of that with you, and I will now turn this over to Commissioner Gosling.
Thank you, Chairman Gingell. Today, of course, I'm very happy to see a lot of people here from the community. It's very important that this issue, of course, we give it to you as quick as we can, the details and so forth. It's very important to get this out to even people in our communities. We are going to have hearings around the county. We have four lined up right now. Let me just kind of announce those, okay, first, so you can write it down. We're going to have the first one on the 22nd of this month, okay, at Waterford Township Hall at 6 p.m. Okay, that's 5500 Circle Drive in Waterford. The second one's going to be the 24th of this month at 7 p.m. at the Rochester Hills, Rochester, and also Poisson Township, and other people are invited too. We can have the OPC there on Linica Drive. The third one is going to be the 25th, their next day, 7 p.m. at Detroit Community Center. And that's on Illinois 3179, Illinois just north of Big Beaver there. The last one that we have scheduled, that means we're not going to have more. We may have more, but at this time we have the fourth. This one's going to be a no-buy on the 29th at 7 p.m. And that's going to be at 45255 West 10 Mile Road. We formed a study group looking at this issue a few months back, and we get a lot of information, but of course, as you know, Judge Cox put a, gag order on the memory inside the room, and of course, for a while, we didn't receive details. We finally got these details about 3 weeks ago, 2 weeks ago, and so now we as county commissioners, 21 of us, represent districts and for your communities, will be voting on to accept this or not. And so we're trying to get ourselves associated and familiar with all the facts and criteria, and believe me, there's a lot of elements here. But this affects generations to come. We're talking green for 40 years, okay? And of course, we're supposed to be gone by then, but then you don't have to set that stage 40 years down the road. Where it's going to go, and so forth. Also, I want to tell you that this is being webcast, and this will be seen on the County Commission website for Oakland County. So, the word has to go out that it is on the website, okay, for Oakland County Commission. And anybody that wants to see it, it covers a lot of details. It's very intense, and it's very detailed. So I also want to introduce the committee, the study committee, which made up of seven members. Myself, Robert Dobson, as chair. We have Mike Bosnick as vice chair. We have Shelly Cobb and John Scott. We also have vice chair Dave Woodward, Gary Gilbury, and Andy Hatchett. Those are the members of the committee. I believe I covered everything. Of course, you're called to WDSD study, I guess we can call it /GLWA, and Great Lakes Water Authority also. So I will turn and ask Jim Nash to come forward and give a word to keep it involved right here. And so ahead, you can just step right up and use the program on my
computer. My office was first introduced to this idea by the city itself, really, the look-back committee that Governor Judge Cox set up in 2011, came up with this proposal. Initially, it was to try to get the judge to do it. The judge then dropped the case about a week and a half later. And a few weeks later from that, Governor Moore came into office as the emergency manager of the city and then reapproached us with kind of the same deal. I brought in Bob and Jerry right away to make sure that we had a united front on this for the county. I've been working closely with them. My office has supplied a lot of direct technical knowledge and information to this operation, and I feel good about it. We were literally banging our heads against the wall with the folks that Kevin Orr set up to negotiate with us. It had come to the point that we were on the verge of just discarding the entire idea. We then went into mediation, and Judge Cox directed us significantly. We came in quite a few times. We worked a lot between the meetings. Mr. Daddow did a significant amount of the work, as I would expect from Oakland County. And we really worked hard to get a deal that actually worked. And initially, the deal that they were proposing, in our minds, didn't work. And it took a significant amount of effort by all our communities, the three counties, the city, in mediation to get this done. I think really this is the best deal that we could have reached on this program. And to me, it gives us the only truly sustainable way of approaching this in the next few decades. As Ms. Godwin said, we're not going to be here. I don't plan on being here in 40 years. But I think what we're setting up is setting up a program that will, over this 40 years, make this the regional authority it should be, and it should have been all along. And I think Oakland County can play a major part in that. As we're approaching this deal, we're working, my office is working very closely with the other counties in the city on helping Veolia do the due diligence that we have to do. We're overseeing that project, and I have some of my best folks overseeing that. So we're looking to make sure that this system is going to be what it should be long term. And it's been very good working with the administration on this. We've been very cooperative, but it's been an excellent adventure, I guess I could say. So I look forward to hearing about this. Jerry's going to be doing a lot of this, and I think we'll have a very good idea. Everybody here will have a very good idea what this is going to be after today. So I thank you for coming out, and I look forward to a good meeting.
Thank you, Jim. And of course, we're going to try to make this an hour long, so get you folks out of here, but we're going to have a question and answer after the presentation. Two of the folks, of course, I will put now on Jim, but Jerry Poisson and Bob Daddow, and they're the ones that did the deep dive, of course, on the facts, working and negotiating. They did a splendid job, I feel, for what they have, because he had a time of phone time and then Detroit. And we know how things are going to keep in Detroit and trying to work through all the issues. By the way, if any of you want to come up and sit in these front seats, you're welcome to get up, get closer to the facts and figures, and you're welcome. Jerry, let me turn it over to you. Bob, go for it.
Thank you, Chairman Guzman. Good morning. Thanks for taking the time to come out. My name is Jerry Poisson. I'm the Chief Deputy County Executive for Oakland County. With my colleague, Bob Daddow, another Deputy County Executive, we were assigned by Brooks Patterson to work with Jim Nash and his fine staff to determine whether or not a deal could be made under the umbrella of bankruptcy, which was the situation that we found ourselves in, that would better the future for the water and sewer customers of the city of Detroit's water and sewage department. Now, Brooks is at a groundbreaking right now for a new DMC hospital, and he should arrive before this meeting's over. But he wants you to understand that he strongly supports this initiative going forward, because he believes, as we do, who are doing the line work, that this is possibly the best we're going to make of an otherwise bad situation. And let me draw that situation up for you just a little bit. The Drain Office has been working for years, now the Water Resources Commissioner's Office, to try and improve the services delivery and to be very frank about it, to end the corruption that was rife in the Water and Sewage Department of Detroit. The first lawsuit that was filed, that Oakland County was a party to, that stayed in existence from its filing date, has a date of 1977. For all that time from 1977 forward, we were in litigation with the City Water and Sewer Department, with the EPA, with the MEDQ, trying to address issues that were rampant within the water and sewer operation. When Detroit's fiscal emergency was declared, we were approached by representatives of the state and of the what became the Office of the Emergency Manager with the idea that we should form an authority. Now, that authority idea had been kicked around previously, but this time it was under the context of bankruptcy. And you should understand that the first offer we got in terms of a written proposal in October of 2013 was what I call a scheme to take over 40 years, $9 billion out of the water and sewer system to be spent on general city operations. Out of the system, not a nickel of that was to be used to improve a system that had literally billions of dollars in needs to save it, quite frankly. That was presented to Wayne Oakland Macomb County. Wayne Oakland Macomb County said, "You gotta be kidding me, absolutely not." And we set some ground rules going forward in terms of positions. Our first ground rule was, if there's a control premium or a lease amount of money to be paid, it absolutely has to stay in the system. The system cannot afford to divert a dollar from the system. There is just too much deferred maintenance, there's too much aged out equipment in there to have anything leave the system. The other rule in the sand was, you have made a commitment to your customers that they can expect no more than 4% increases in what's called the revenue requirement going forward for a period of time. So we determined that one of our other ground rules would be any lease payment or control premium, whatever you want to call it, would have to be essentially revenue neutral within those numbers. And by that we mean that within the constellation of revenues that are already anticipated to come into the system through existing contract revenues, through anticipated future 4% rates, we had to find the money within that amount to justify the payment of the $50 million. It has to come from there. This can't be a new charge. And so, as the hearings progressed, actually they fell apart a time or two, because until really the last 6 weeks or so, the city did not come to the same agreement with us that the money had to stay in the system. And what really happened there was, the mayor of the city of Detroit, Mike Duggan, became involved at that point personally. Before that, the water department was in the control of the emergency manager. Our negotiations were with the emergency manager's teams, who were basically investment bankers, looking for ways to maximize the revenue out of the water and sewer fund to pay the other general creditors of the city of Detroit. He came on, he was briefed by his team. He instantly agreed with us that the system can't afford the diversion of any funds. And so he adopted that policy, and then he worked with us and convinced the state and then convinced the emergency manager's office that that was a rational way to move forward, in fact, the only way that could work. So Judge Cox became the federal court mediator. There was a gag order, so we tried the best we could to keep our boards of commissioners involved within the confines of the fact that we were warned twice a week that we can't say anything to anybody under penalty of contempt over details. And so when this finally broke and an MOU was executed just a couple weeks ago, and we were given the opportunity to talk to our board, and we were given the opportunity to talk to our citizens who will be affected by that, and this is where we're at now. Now, I have a short, hopefully, PowerPoint. I'm going to do part of it. Daddow's going to do the fiscal part of it to give you a high-level view of what it is we're doing here. So what we're asked the board to do, with the support of Jim Nash, the Water Resources Commissioner, and Brooks Patterson, the County Executive, is to form a new form of governance. It's a governance form for the Water and Sewer Department, the regional, the Great Lakes Regional Water Authority. The goal was to find a system that was fair and affordable, accountable and transparent, and oh, by the way, sustainable. We are worried about the long-term sustainability of the system. The people at the table, City of Detroit, of course, it's their system. The County of Wayne, County of Macomb, the County of Oakland, and the State of Michigan.
The state of Michigan is sitting in. Obviously, they had an interest in the overall bankruptcy, but it also, because the DWSD actually touches 8 counties in the state of Michigan, the overwhelming majority of the customers are in Wayne, Oakland, Macomb. But to represent those other areas, the governor's at the table. We have a couple of other core values that we think we have in Oakland County government, those being transparency and accountability. We wanted to make sure that we put in whatever governing structure was settled upon the fact that we have to be transparent. And as the Articles of Incorporation call for, a procurement process that is competitively based, requires all the contracts to be posted online and to be available. And there are some other protections in terms of audits and audit committees reporting directly to the board. The idea of a water authority is that it would operate and maintain all of the regional assets of the system. What's called common to all assets now. These are pipes and pump stations and sewage treatment plants and water filtration plants. We're going to have them operated by the regional authority. We've got a quick map of the water supply system showing you who gets their water from the city system. Here is a sewage treatment plant. I know these are hard to see, but there's a little bit of a segue. Right now, you can go online to oakgov.com. And you can either follow this PowerPoint online, or you can download it later. All this information is out there at oakgov.com. Who's going to be responsible for Detroit's local system? The city of Detroit is. The city of Detroit is going to maintain complete responsibility for their retail system of water and sewer pipes. That's about 6,400 miles of pipes that are under the ground in the city. They, by retaining responsibility for that, they also retain their responsibility to pay the total cost for it. One of the issues we long had was that we've all read about the delinquencies, non-payment, which is a pretty high number in terms of better than $140 million are over 60 days old even today. We were not going to pick up the liability for that as suburban ratepayers. That was one of our core values. Under the agreement that's before the board, the city becomes a wholesale customer, just like the residents of Oakland County are wholesale customers through their local communities. It's the community that gets the water and sewer bill in total. It's the community that has the obligation to pay the water department for their bill. That's how the city is going to operate. They're going to be a wholesale customer. They're going to get a bill for water and sewer services that are delivered, and then it's up to them to find a way to pay for it. Obviously, the primary way is through collections from the customers. If they don't reach it that way, then they have to look to other sources of revenue to pay the bills. The Detroit water and sewer capital needs will be funded by the lease payment, and that helps us in the suburban communities by limiting our exposure. Again, there's 3,000 miles of water pipes, about 3,400 miles of sewer pipes. We don't know the condition they're in. We know they're not in good condition. Their average age is 80 years. That's an average. So I can tell you how much is older than that. And they have a significant leakage problem. How does that affect you? Well, if the water leaks out of the water pipes, it goes into the sewage system. We capture it, we treat it again as a common to all cost. We pay for treating the water that has become sewage by in the system. To the extent they can fix those pipes, we can reduce our costs on the sewage side. We can reduce the cost of capital structures. There's 5 water filtration plants right now. They probably need 3.5. If the leaks are fixed, they can get by with 3. So as they improve the system, the common to all costs that we all pay will go down over the next 5 to 8 years. The current makeup, the seat at the table, what are we getting in exchange for this $50 million set aside to be spent in Detroit on their capital improvements? What are the suburban ratepayers getting? Well, we're getting a seat at the table that we select. And in terms of suburban interest, being non-city interest, there's 4 new seats at the table. There'll be a Macomb seat, a Wayne seat, an Oakland County seat, and the governor will appoint an at-large seat from a resident of an area that served by the Detroit Water and Sewer Department, but exists outside the Tri-County area. So a six-member board, Detroit still has two. Why does Detroit have two? Because they own it. So it doesn't get any deeper than that. We can't have a regional system unless Detroit comes along, because they're the title owner of the system, and they'll remain the title owner. We think we improve management by continuing with the judge imposed relatively recently, and that's a credentials-based members of the board. They have to have at least 7 years' experience in law, accounting, finance, engineering, in a regulated utility, people with some gravamen and experience to sit at that table, and to run the operations and operations of deliver services, and nothing else. We get the protection of supermajority voting requirements for major decisions. This means that for major decisions, issuing debt, setting rates or rate protocols, hiring an executive director, setting any compensation for board members, removing a board member for cause, adoption of an annual budget, and the annual adoption of a rolling five-year capital improvement plan, it takes 5 to 6 votes. So as you can see, the suburban interest, if you will, I call it the wholesale customer interest, is protected by this supermajority requirement. And our position was that if we needed to object to something, we need to be able to convince just one other partner that it's not right. And then perhaps if we can't convince one other partner that it's not right, maybe then we're not right. So 5 of 6 is where we ended up with. There's a simple majority required for our other operations, 4, if you will, of 6 votes. And again, it shows that it can't be dominated by the city, if that's a concern, because the 4 suburban interests can always hang together. Taken together, what we were trying to do with the voting structure, we really mirrored a little bit off the COBO authority, regional authority, the SMART board of directors, it's a regional authority, the RTA that you haven't heard too much about, but that idea. The idea is to make sure everybody had to treat each other fairly or nothing would get done. And I've been on the SMART board since 1999, and I think we've had one vote where there was disagreement. You have to treat everybody with equal respect and weigh and balance out the benefits to everybody if you expect to get your budget passed, if you expect to operate. And so this model's been successful in the past, and we decided we wanted to carry that forward here. I'm going to take a break for a minute and have Bob Daddow come in and talk to you about the fiscal protections in the law. Bob headed a team of CFOs from both the state, an outside consultant, and the other counties. He did a deep dive of the revenue projections and capital improvement projections to make the determination fiscally of whether or not this project was feasible, and I'll let him address that.
Thank you. Jerry's covered some of the fiscal items, so I may be a little bit redundant here in some of the discussion topics I have. But one of the first ones we have identified here is that the new authority has no power to levy taxes, not levy property taxes at all, not within the confines of its responsibility, similar to what exists today. The other item that we have is an affirmative. That we wouldn't do, and I don't think it was discussed much, although it was on the table at one time, is that, and broached several times thereafter, is to offer our full faith and credit as a county in order to essentially help the credit worthiness of the bonds. The problem here is that if we were to do so, or Macomb County were to do so, it would have an adverse problem, if you will, on our AAA bond rating. And that wasn't something that was being offered, nor included in the articles of incorporation. It says the full faith and credit won't be offered up for bonding in the new authority. Jerry's right. One of the critical items that we had literally almost 10 months of debate on happened to have been the notion that the money stayed in the system. The original proposal was $9 billion out of the system over a 40-year time frame, leaving, of course, all the deferred maintenance unresolved, the operating issues, and so forth, putting upward pressure on the the fee rate, of course, or fees that would be charged in the new authority. That was unacceptable. Somewhere about December or January, they moved to what you heard was the $47 million payment out of the system. That too was unacceptable. We held firm, and quite frankly, absent the dollars staying in the system, we probably wouldn't have an authority today. The dollars will stay in the system as contemplated. All of the money, all the revenue of the new authority coming in, of course, will be used to help the system itself. That could be in the form of water and sewer fees, grants, contributions. The list is on the effort that are up there now, proceeds from the sale of bonds and so forth, and potentially even the sale of some equipment or land they might own, if you will. Some of that's going to be ferreted out over the next several months before we actually launch the authority formally. To that end, the $50 million. You've been hearing payment of $50 million. The payment of $50 million is really coming out. We spent a fair amount of time in validating the $50 million. The $50 million itself came about as a result of to some extent, an anticipated sewer bond issue in the amount of $150 million. The due diligence relating to a city that's in bankruptcy that has to be performed in order to secure a bond is pretty substantial. It involves financial advisors, it involves underwriters, it involves a lot of folks here, and one of the key functions was, is there acceptable debt coverage? And to that end, there is a fair amount of due diligence performed over a 9-year or day period outside of this CFO committee that was established. We piggybacked on that because experts were going to put their professional reputations online. And if you know anything about bonding in governments today, effective in early January, the regulations pertaining to municipal bonding sets forth penalties that run not to the entity, but to the individuals assembling the official statements themselves. And there have been a number of spectacular cases where mayors or similar folks, even making mentions in states of the state of the county, state of the city addresses, wind up getting regulatory sanctions by the SEC. So the people themselves were on the hook. Now what does that mean? It means the credibility of the numbers that we had, established a higher standard than had been existing in DWSD in prior situations. The water side of the equation, we went for some period of time using the same approach in terms of the projections to validate the $50 million. But ultimately, when they did the tender offer on the bonds that occurred in August, that received the same expert review from financial advisors and similar folks, as did the sewer system. Ultimately, what we were looking at in by the CFOs made its way into the tender offer. So we feel pretty comfortable that the $50 million, after funding getting the money from the revenues, the operating and paying the debt service, was available through the cash flow going forward for the next 5 years. The sewer system's a little weak in the first couple of years in the cash flow after consideration of the $50 million. Their share of it. The water system is in a little bit tougher strait, but still is able to cover their own piece. Now, the lease covers itself two pieces. We're leasing essentially the wholesale assets, which are suburban assets, what we consider to be non-Detroit areas. But also, if you will, the common to all plants. The common to all interceptors or the mains that connect from the plant to the local systems outside the system. To that end, the payment comes from future operations that are, and I put this in bold, already part of the operations. Now, how are we doing that? As part of the bankruptcy proceedings, there are several different things that are occurring. one of which happens to be that we had a commitment of paying part of the pension certificates of participation debt service. To that end, most of that debt service is going to go away in bankruptcy. You've been reading about that. This is the Sucora and the FIDGET, FDIC, discussions, who are assuring bonds. Most of that debt service is eliminated. That frees up money that was already included within the rates to cover this effort, for the effort. That's about $14 million. In addition, you've also read about the retirees' health care that has been restructured as part of the bankruptcy. To that end, that frees up about $18 million a year paid from the rates. So that gets you to about $32 million. That service relating to the pension certificates of participation is fixed. Obviously, the OPEB retirees' health care is not fixed. It's going to go up, or it would have gone up. Today it was $18 million, tomorrow it's going to be $20 million, 5 years from now it'll be $25 million, 10 years from now, who knows. By eliminating that particular fringe benefit offered to the employees, the advantage here is that frees up dollars and fixes the dollar amount in the form of what they call B notes. B notes is essentially some notes they're going to issue to the VBA sometime in 2015, probably winter or spring. That fixes our dollar amount pertaining to that fringe benefit going forward. Frees up dollars. We're also going to bond, although the details are not yet resolved, bond for what was turned out to be the pension acceleration, which was part of the grand bargain. To that end, that will free up dollars that are already projected in the budget for the next 5 years, of somewhere in the order of about $20 million. Those three items alone cover the $50 million, but we didn't stop there. Veolia, a international company that operates utilities such as water and sewer systems, is conducting a study at our urging. Oakland urged the state to fund the study. It's always great when you can get some state dollars. And they're paying for a study to be conducted over the next 2 months, ending with a report ending sometime at the end of October. That report hopefully will provide a series of recommendations, since they're bringing in upwards of 40 experts for that 2 month period. They're going to go up and down that place, left and right. And to that end, that report ought to provide some additional recommendations that we would be able to implement as a new authority board. Although, quite frankly, today I can't quantify it because the information is not available. There is a monitoring committee that's been formed. I believe that Mr. Nash has one person on the committee for the water side and one person on the committee for the sewer side. And the counties of McComb and Wayne have representatives as well on that committee, and they're meeting, as I understand, weekly. So to that end, sometime in late October, we'll have something available that might provide additional savings that would further free up cash flow for the $50 million. The labor contracts and the vendor contracts will be honored as drafted, as they are today. That was another requirement, and to some extent, some of that statutory as well. So there's nothing really that we could do other than to accept the Michigan laws in honoring, for example, the labor contracts going over. A lot's been talked about on the 4% cap issue. Again, that cap is for billings to the wholesale customers. As you know, that the EWSD does bill to wholesale customers. That's the customers there are the local units of government, Birmingham, Bloomfield, Beverly Hills, and so forth. And that dollar amount includes water and sewer services up to a point. The point happens to be the demarcation point where the infrastructure ends at DWSD, and the local units pick up that responsibility from that demarc point to the houses or businesses. The local units are responsible for that retail service not least of which happens to be the collections of those amounts and billings for that effort. Now, the commitment here is only to deal with a commitment of a 4% cap on the wholesale billings to the local governmental units, the wholesale customers, if you will. Detroit, as Jerry has said, is going to become a wholesale customer. They're also going to be responsible for the system. Now, what does that do for us? It provided us two other problems being resolved. The first problem happened to have been the backstopping issue on the poor collections the city of Detroit has been doing. You've been seeing the shutoff discussions, if you will, going on for the last several months. We aren't going to be responsible for that as part of the authority. City of Detroit will, going forward. To that end, if they collect a dollar, they collect it all. They're responsible for whatever they don't collect because they have to pay the wholesale bill for the water and sewer services. That was a proposal we put out in October. It was soundly rejected by the EMS team, but endorsed by Mayor Daddow. Second issue here. We had a lot of discussion on the condition of the aged system. Jerry indicated it could be 80 years old. Frankly, there is no assessment being done on the depth of the problem for the system in Detroit. We don't know. Quite frankly, there's four construction plans out there that we looked at. They use different assumptions, different periods, different projects, having different dollar amounts over different periods, and they're hardly consistent. Created a problem for us. But as the retail owners of the system for the city of Detroit, Detroit assumes the responsibility for resolving its own local system, not the authority. That essentially took off the table a significant uncertainty of us entering into this effort. In the discussions in the January timeframe, the draft MOU, which we rejected out of hand, if for no other reason than this proposal, indicated that if the city of Detroit, it's not on the table, and this was rejected, if the city of Detroit could not afford to cover an operating need to remediate the infrastructure, it would be the authority's responsibility to step in and remediate, and then attempt to collect from whomever they could get it from. Well, that would have become a problem. That was not on the table, it was rejected, and part to some of the discussions that caused us to have heartburn on the discussions over the period before we entered mediation. The $50 million is a common to all effort to be paid for by both the city and the county. Right now, the relative relationship of the retail, what they call the retail, which covers not only Detroit's wholesale, but retail operations. The city of Detroit pays about a third, the wholesale customers today, as defined, pay about two-thirds. So suburban customers pay two-thirds of the operations, the water and sewer, the city pays about a third. The relationship is expected to be relatively the same in the payment process for the $50 million going forward. We've also included a couple of other items in there, not least of which is the multi-year budgeting, starting in the year 2017. The reason why we had to defer that is because the existing city system is being replaced by DWSD, and the likely cutover period will occur on July 1st, 2016. So to that end, we won't be able to actually be able to deal with the budgeting process until that point in time, so it had to be deferred for 2 years. Mayor Duggan has emphasized on numerous occasions during the mediation process that he endorses transparency. Oakland County is very much transparent. We have a website that is second to none, and we put up everything we possibly can for the benefit of the city, the contractors, and others, and the residents. We have another program that we talked about and created or will create as part of the authority, and that's called the RAP. The only thing that really, to be honest with you here on the effort, the only, out of the four words, water residential affordability program, the only two that seem to be holding are the water and program. We keep changing the term residential, resident, retail. It's been a number of things, and affordability and has changed a number of times as well. What we do like is the RAP. So you may see the actual name when we get down to defining it to change slightly, but the acronym is still going to be RAP. Now what does that do? One of the things that we have as a problem in Detroit, and still do, as well as other communities, Highland Park, Hamtramck, Ecorse, Rural Township, Pontiac, and so forth, is there's a number of low-income folks couldn't pay their bills. And to some extent, that's still the case. Nationally, the programs that deal with the low-income folks have usually set aside upwards of 0.5% in their revenues for programs to assist the individuals. And to that end, the authority will launch in 2015 a RAP program that not only benefits the low-income folks for Detroit, but also the wholesale customer low-income folks in the suburbs. Now, the criteria has yet to be defined, and that's really the responsibility of the authority once they get up and running. But the approximate dollar amount annually that will be set aside in this area will be essentially $4.5 million. One last item I need to go back on the $50 million that I forgot to mention. The $50 million will be paid into a fund within the body of the authority, under the control of the authority, but for the benefit of the city infrastructure needs. And to that end, some folks might say, well, my God, you know, that's the city, and what benefit do we get? Well, if you look at some of the components, such as the water leaking that Jerry had mentioned, the advantage to us here is substantial. Right now, the city moved from a building in 1999 of about 125 million gallons a day on average, down to about 63 million gallons a day billed, if you will, for the water. They cut it in half because over a 15-year period of time. The problem here is to get to the billed water in Detroit or in other areas, like Dearborn and Detroit system seem to be somewhat linked. They have to produce 150 million gallons, up to 150 million gallons a day, that essentially flows out of the water plants after having been cleaned, out to the field, and back into the sewers, to come back to the sewer plant to be cleaned. It's nuts. And you've read about that and seen, you know, some of the spectacular cases where water's been running for a long period of time in the house, in part caused by vandals. One of the things that the mayor is intending on doing is taking that $50 million and monetizing it. Now, what does that mean? Monetizing means that he's going to issue a bond and use the payment on an annual basis, or some portion of it, 30 to 40 million, to pay debt service. What does that do? It provides us the ability here, through the authority, to deal with some of these infrastructure needs not over a 40-year period of time, but over a 3 or 4 year period of time now, to deal with things such as the water leaks. And if you don't think you're paying for some of the water leaks that go out from the river to the plant, out in the field, and back into the sewer system, only to go back in the river, you're crazy. You're paying for it, to some extent. How much? Have no idea. But if we could stop that process from occurring, and that benefits not only the city residents, but it also benefits the suburban customers. A problem facing us yet is the CSO problem in 2022, which may be able to be mitigated by virtue of reducing the water flowing through the system and thereby freeing up capacity that gives us the ability to avoid a permit problem in 2022. And that permit problem is expensive. And it deals with rainy days. And we've seen that on occasion. To that end, that permit problem may be able to be mitigated if we can do enough investments going forward. The plan calls for about $1.2 billion worth of investment over the next 5 years through bonding, either through state revolving fund bonding or alternatively outside bonding going into the market. The bond rating has improved as a result of the city coming out of bankruptcy and restructuring its debt. The authority itself will further improve the interest rates. Some say upwards of 35 to 50 basis points. If you drop the interest rates, you reduce the costs. The regional authority will assist in that effort. All of these things are working pieces in the finance effort. And I can talk for another couple hours. You don't want that. And we got to be out of here in a relatively period of time. And Jerry has a few more things to talk about. I'm going to turn it over to him. And then Jerry will take all your questions.
I'll be brief. What's next? Under the terms of the MOU, and these dates are really established by the bankruptcy court, we need to close off the bankruptcy action and to have any agreement really wrapped into a bankruptcy final order. The city council and the commissioners from the three counties have until October 10th to decide whether they're going to be in or they're going to be out. Under the law, under Act 233, it takes two municipalities to create an authority. So obviously the city's got to go because the city owns the assets right now. So as soon as any one county after the city gets in, and the city will be in by either the city council approving it or the emergency manager approving it or both, any one other county launches the authority. Why is that important? Well, the articles provide that if there's a county that doesn't join the authority, then the governor of the state of Michigan will appoint somebody to represent the interests of the ratepayers in that county. But the county will lose the opportunity to appoint their own representative. Equally important, and this was something that was introduced to Mr. Daddow and I 18 months ago at our very first meeting with representatives of the investment bankers in the state, is Act 233 expressly provides that if an authority is formed, and if you're not an incorporating municipality, you can be charged a greater rate for the water and sewer services than incorporating municipalities. And so there's a financial incentive for us to be an incorporated member in that we at least have to be treated the same as incorporated members in terms of overall rate set. Under the articles, the form will start, we have 200 days. There's a lot to do. If the board's approved and the authority's formed, within 200 days, the master lease has to be negotiated. The master lease will set out in detail not only all the provisions of the MOU, but all the really important things to actually have a system that operates that is the engineering component. What assets, where, and do all the title searches for the real estate that's being leased, etc. So that's a 200-day process. Why is there a time limit on it? 200 days seems like a long time, but given the volume of work and the number of parcels of land to look at, it's going to be tough. But you have to keep everybody's feet to the fire. There's some escape clauses in the articles, all right? The automatic dissolution is what it's called. If any time before the issuance of debt, a bankruptcy court or another court of competent jurisdiction changes something in the plan of adjustment that would affect adversely the authority, and this is the plan of adjustment that was filed on just Tuesday. This is the seventh plan of adjustment. And anything in here affecting DWSC, if it changes what's in the MOU, the authority automatically dissolves when it's created. If within 200 days of the effective date, the board fails to approve and execute a lease to lease the systems, the water system, the sewer system, if there's no lease executed in 200 days, the authority to form automatically dissolves. If there is anything in the lease that is executed that is in material respect, deviates from a memorandum of understanding, again, it's online for you to read, the authority automatically dissolves. A little bit of a chicken and egg thing on how you do this, but you can't have an authority negotiate a lease until the authority exists. So the first step has to be the start of the authority. You have to create the authority first. We talked about how the governor appoints and how you can be charged a greater rate. I realize this is quick and this is not hardly in depth as it could be. But what we want to do is give you a quick overview, point you to the websites that have more detail, and actually the articles of incorporation are on the website for you to download, as is the memorandum of understanding, as is a list of frequently asked questions, as is this PowerPoint, as is a side-by-side of what you have with the authority and without the authority and some of the changes. We'd urge you to look at that. If you have questions, call Mr. Nash, call Mr. Daddow and myself. Talk to your county commissioner, have them feed us questions. Our goal is to put out publicly as much information as we can to help you understand what's happening. I want to emphasize one more thing for those of you who are cities with existing contracts. Those existing contracts are assumed in their totality. You will continue to realize the benefits of the bargain that you have previously negotiated. You would be customers. The customer contracts are merely being transferred. There's a new governing entity at the top of the contracts will be under.